So we completed half of the chapter, I think more than half of the chapter, and we are left with just two sections. One is the missing values, where there are two types of missing values. One is explicitly missing values, which are actually flagged by any, and implicit missing values, which means simply the data is not present. So one way to think about the difference is an explicit missing value is a presence of an absence. An implicit missing value is the absence of a presence. So, okay. If we look at this table, stocks table, and we try to pivot it to wider form, we find that some of the values in 2015 and 2016 is missing. So, one of the pivoting this by wider would reveal that the implicit missing values are there, which is in 2016, and can be controlled by values drop any argument. Okay, so what does complete do now? Complete takes in columns and completes the DF for all the potential combination of values in there. Like it takes a year and quarter and takes the combination 2015, 1, 2, 3, 4, and again 2016, 1, 2, 3, 4, and completes it for you. And yeah, wherever there is no value, it will fill any. Fill. So fill can be used to fill in the gaps with the preceding or a following value. A very common practice what we do. So if we look at this table treatment, and when we use fill person, it repeats the value of whichever is above it. So that's why we have direct with more repeatedly coming in the resultant vector, in the resultant table. The first question is compare and contrast the fill arguments to pivot wider and complete. So fill arguments is in both pivot wider and complete. Values underscore fill is the argument for pivot wider, which requires a single value or a named list. So apart in complete, we have the fill argument, which only takes a named list. So, but you can still give us it a single value, but it should be as a named list. We'll see the example. And these both can be used to replace both implicit and explicit missing values. So if you see the example here in pivot wider, values fill is just a number, and it'll fill wherever there is no value to zero, NA to zero. While in complete, it needs a list. So it returns zero. And yeah, wherever the values are in A, it is zero. What does the direction argument to fill do? So the direction argument helps in determining the direction of filling the missing values. The options are down, default, which replaces by previous non-NA value. That means the upper, whichever is above it, and replaces with the following and up replaces with the following non-NA values. There are some other way as well, down, up, and up, down. Okay, so yeah, that's all the questions for missing value. Next, we move to case study. So the tidy WHO data contains tuberculosis cases broken down by year, country, age, gender, and diagnosis method. The data comes from the 2014 World Health Organization Global Tuberculosis Report. So if you just look at the data, it has country, ISO 2, ISO 3, year, and these special names, new SP, M014. So usually when I looked at the data set, it said that this is like a code, it's like a key, which is the new or the old case. And then this is SP and REL is a kind of, I think it's a different kinds of tuberculosis, and M and F are the gender, and 0 to 14 is the age gap, age range. So, and 0 to 14, 15 to 24, so on and so forth. So let's clean this data a little bit. This was already provided in the book. Using pivot longer and changing all these special into longer format and giving them the name as key, and values to cases, and then drop NA, and then also do a mutate here. We'll see why we are doing a mutate here, where we are replacing the new REL to NEU underscore REL and separating the key. to new variable and sex age, and also removing the columns which are redundant, and separating sex age by sex and age using a separator. In question one, the case study, in this case studies, I set values underscore drop underscore NA equal to true, just to make it easier to check that we had the correct values. Is this reasonable? Think about how missing values are represented in this data set. Are they implicit missing values? What's the difference between an NA and zero? So I think that's very simple. If there are no zero values in the data, then the missing values may be used to indicate no cases. And if there are both implicit and explicit missing values, then it suggests that missing values are being used differently. In that case, it is likely that explicit missing values would mean no cases, and implicit missing values would mean no data on the number of cases. So yeah. The next question is, what happens if we neglect the mutate step and we don't do this replacement? We see that the separate will show a warning saying it expected three pieces, and in your sex and age, you find that wherever there is new REL, it's all together and it has not been separated. So it's very important we separate it correctly, mutate a new column, new name, and change it to in new underscore REL, and only then the separation can be easier. Okay, I claim that ISO 2 and ISO 3 were redundant with country. Confirm this claim. So I just did using the shortest method possible, which is checking the number of distinct rows in country ISO and ISO 2 and 3. I think it's also standard format of some countries and some codes. So both of them were same. So yeah, all three of them are redundant columns. Okay, so the last question would be, for each country, year, and sex, compute the total number of cases of TB. Make an informative visualization of the data. So right now, I just took the values for year above 1995 and showed the cases on the y-axis and year on the x-axis with the sex as the color of the graph. I have not shown the country as such. So if you all have any suggestion, please let me know. I have used the same data set what was cleaned before. So yeah. Okay, so end of the chapter, non-tidy data. So why do we need to use, where do we need to use tidy data and where not? I'm just going to pick up the lines from the book. There are two main reasons to use other data structures. Alternative representations may have substantial performance or space advantages. Yeah, that is for sure. Sometimes it doesn't work the tidy way. And specialized fields have evolved their own conventions for storing data that may be quite different to the conventions of tidy data. So either of the reasons means you'll need something other than a table or a data frame. If your data does not fit naturally into a rectangular structure composed of observation and variables, I think tidy data should be your default choice. But there are good reasons to use other structures. Tidy data is not the only way. Yeah, and if you would like to know more about non-tidy data, look at this blog post by Jeff Leek, which is Simply Statistics Non-Tidy Data. I think that's all from my side. Any questions? Okay, if there are no questions, Arnab, can you take over?
Yeah, sure. Hi, nice to see you, everyone.
Hi.
Sorry, I could not attend the last few classes. My coursework was like too hectic. Nonetheless, let's get started. So the next chapter is really exciting. It's about relational data, and it talks about how to work with multiple tables and how to kind of join different tables based on primary key and foreign key, etc. Let me share my screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
All right. So I think I really enjoyed this chapter. I found that a lot of concepts that this chapter has were drawn from SQL. And knowing a bit of SQL is always very helpful when we are working with multiple data sets. This chapter thoroughly uses the NYC Flights 13 data, which we worked with earlier during our visualization chapter and other chapters as well. And here we kind of get into some of the other tables that are used, that sort of come with the NYC package. We had been working with the flights data set, which had variables like year, month, day, hour, flight, origin, destination, tail number, etc. But there are additional data sets or additional tables that contain other related information. For example, airport contains information about the name of the airport, the latitude and the longitude of the airport. The table called weather contains information on year, month, day, and different weather conditions like precipitation and wind speed and humidity and so on. And airlines contains information on the name of the carrier, etc. So the chapter kind of begins by distinguishing between different types of keys. And we see that, it kind of elaborates on the three different, the three major kinds of keys that are used in, relational database concepts. The first one being primary key. So primary key is essentially a variable or a set of variables that can be used to uniquely define each row in a table. So for example, in the flights dataset, we can uniquely define each row in that table by using a combination of year, month, day, hour, and then flight. Similarly, in the weather table, each row can be uniquely defined by year, month, day, hour, and then origin, which is the name of the airport. So that's the role of primary key, which is kind of helps in ensuring that there are no duplicates and that every row is uniquely identified by the primary key. Which brings us to the concept of a foreign key, which is nothing. So foreign key is nothing but a primary key in some other table. So for example, this airport's data has a row called FAA, which is nothing but another name for the name of the airport. So FAA is a primary key in the airports table, and it kind of plays the role of it is a part of the primary key in some other table. I mean, if it is a part of some other maybe this is not a good example. Tail number is a good example, I think. Now I'm a bit confused what I read. Those were the two kinds of keys. Let me get back to that in a couple of minutes. And then the third type of key was the surrogate key, which is for cases when there are no primary keys that are available inbuilt in a particular data set. Users can kind of use the row number to create a new key, which uniquely defines every row, of course. So when users do that, that new key becomes the surrogate key. So with that, the first exercise kind of starts with saying that, you know, imagine you wanted to draw the route that each plane flies from its origin to its destination. What variables would you need? Which kind of hints at the fact that we would somehow need data not only on the origin and the destination, but also on the latitude and longitude of the origin as well as that of the destination. So actually, let us also talk about inner joins in a bit. Yeah, so this brings us to the concept of inner joins, which is described a little late in the chapter. So inner joins is a way to, actually let's skip this particular problem, and I'll revisit this question too when we discuss the second bit. The second question of the first exercise is that, you know, I forgot to draw the relationship between weather and airports. What is the relationship and how should it appear in the diagram? So here we see that we have multiple tables, and the question is to draw a relationship between weather and airport. So looking at the two data sets, we can see that the FAA variable in the airports, which is right here, and the origin variable right here in the weather table, so these are related. So FAA is kind of the name of the airport, and origin is the name of the airport from where a flight is originating. So FAA is a primary key in the airports table, and it would play the role of a foreign key in the weather table, because here it would kind of be a part of the primary key in the weather table. So if we were to draw a relationship, there would be a line that comes from this FAA variable, and it would kind of join the weather table at the origin variable. The next question was weather only contains information for origin airport. So this is the data set that contains all flights that originated from airports in New York. So the question is, if this data set contained weather records for all the airports in USA, what additional relation would it define with flights? So we are comparing the data set on weather and flights, and we are kind of trying to understand if this weather data set also had another, I mean, if instead of containing information only on origin, if it contained information on all other airports, then what would the relationship look like? Now, looking at this, the relationship between these two tables, we see that this origin or the primary key in the weather table is related to the flights through year, month, day, hour, flight, and origin. However, if instead of only having data on origin, if it had information on all other airports in USA, that would mean that we could possibly link origin as well as the destination, assuming that both origin and destination are within the United States. So the change that would happen in these relationships is that in addition to a link with origin, there would be an additional link that would connect the weather data set to the destinations column in the flights data set as well. So that is how the relationship should change. And finally, the next question is, we know that some days of the year are special and fewer people than usual fly on them. How might you represent that data as a data frame? And what would be the primary keys of that table? How would it connect to existing tables? So here I create a new table called special and assign it values like, you know, there are random dates and then there are random holidays like dog's day or cat's day and panda's day. And this is how the table looks like. Now, in this table, since each row contains information on a holiday, the primary key would be a combination of year, month, and day. That special table would connect with all other tables. For example, the special table would connect with the year, month, and day in the flights table. It would connect with the year, month, and day in the weather table, and so on. Does that make sense?
Yes, it's a combined primary key, no?
Yeah. So it's a combination of year, month, and day that creates a primary key for the new special table. And it would connect to all other tables wherever there are year, month, or day to kind of identify like special holidays. So that was the end of the first exercise, barring the first question, which we'll come back to in a bit. Then it comes to this idea of keys, which are, you know, primary key, which uniquely identifies an observation in its own table. And foreign key, as I was talking about, it uniquely identifies an observation in some other table. And this is the part that I got a little bit confused about. So the example that they took is, flights dollar tail number is a foreign key because it appears in the flights table where it matches each flight to a unique plane. So flights dollar tail number is a primary key in the, tail number is a primary key in the planes table. But then tail number is a foreign key in the flights table because it's kind of a primary key in some other table. Did that make sense or did I confuse everyone?
No. I understood it. Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. So that's the difference between like a primary key and a foreign key. And this chapter tells a really cool way to identify primary key, which is to use tidyverse to first select the data set and then count the number of rows for a particular, the number of unique rows within a particular variable, and then filter to see how many of those rows have a count of more than one. So, for example, if we get into the data set of planes, which was right here, and tail number was its primary key, and we count the number of unique tail numbers and then filter for all cases that have an N of more than one, we see that there are no rows, which essentially means that tail number is a primary key for planes. However, within the weather data set, which was right here, which had, apparently year, month, day, hour, and origin as the primary key, we add all of those. We add year, month, day, hour, and origin, and count the number of unique cases based on these five columns. And then we filter to see if there are any cases where there are multiple rows that are identified by a combination of these five variables. We see that there are cases where There are three instances. There are three cases where year, month, day, hour, and origin kind of has more than one rule. So, for example, on this particular day and this particular hour, there were two flights that had the same origin as EWR, which essentially means that this is not a very effective primary key because it does, because a combination of these five variables does not uniquely identify each row in the weather data set. And that is the instance where the authors suggest the use of a surrogate key. So in cases where we find that there's no combination of variables that kind of uniquely identify each row in our data set, the authors say that let's just use mutate and row number to create a new variable that contains the row number of each case, and that would be our, you know, created key or a surrogate key. And yeah, that's the distinction between a primary key and a foreign key and a surrogate key, which brings us to the next exercise, which is the first question is, you know, very simple, add a surrogate key to the flights data set. So we have flights right here. We have year, month, day, departure. And if we were to add a surrogate key, we create a new data set, flights underscore surrogate, and we mutate to create a new key, which is nothing but the row number. And then we use the surrogate key and the year, month, day, and tail number to kind of look at the data. So here, since we have used row number to generate the new key, I mean, it would obviously be, it would uniquely identify each row and it can be used as a primary key instead of having a, I mean, in cases when the data set does not inherently have a primary key. The next data set, the next question is to identify, you know, primary keys in the following data sets. So we have a lot of new data sets. We have the batting data set from the layman package. We have the baby names data set from the baby names package. And let's look at one of them. So this is the batting data set, which has, I don't know which game this is. I'm guessing this is baseball. But we have player ID, we have year ID, and we have stint, and we have team ID, and I think it's league ID. I'm not sure. I'm not very familiar with the game. But if we were to identify primary key in this data set, we'll do what they did earlier in the chapter, where we first count the number of unique rows on a set of columns, and then filter to see if they have you know, any cases where where there are more than one rows that are identified by these columns. So I initially started with you know, player ID. So I did something like this, and I saw that, you know, there are about 10 rows where, you know, player ID is duplicated. So this player ID is being duplicated 9 times. This player ID appears 23 times in the data set. So I thought, okay, let's now do maybe player ID and year ID. So we add year ID to it, and we see that, just give me one second, and we see that, you know, there are again 10 rows or 10 cases where a combination of player ID and year ID is again getting duplicated. So this player ID played in this year, and that appears 2 times. So this is also of no use. So then I add stint. I do not understand what the stint variable is per se in this game, but that seems to work. So it may be that in a year there are multiple seasons, and, you know, we are kind of capturing the number of the kind of index of stint that each player had, and then we see that there are no duplicate rows, which means that the combination of player ID, year ID, and stint uniquely identifies each row in the data set. So that's like a method to identify the primary key in the data. I take another example. I did not do all the examples. It's easy to get the sense of it. But I also did baby names, and we see that this is baby names data set, which has these six five columns, which is year, sex, name, number of times that name was used in the database. I think this is coming from the social securities database in the United States, and the proportion of people that year who had that name. So these are all the columns, and it's kind of intuitive. So what we can do is we can take a combination of year and sex and name, and that would give us a unique key. Although this might not have been very unique, because it might have Mary might have, I don't know, this does not have a last name or anything. This might have led into multiple rows. It kind of worked here, but in case it had not worked, we would, there are no other variables that we could have used. We would have been forced to create a surrogate key in this case as well. Let that run. We can move on to the next table, which is draw a diagram illustrating the connections between batting, people, and salaries table in the layman package. So the layman package had more information. It had information on batting, which we saw, but it also had information in a separate table on people. I think that indicates players, and salaries that the players drew. I'll just stop this. So let's take a quick look at those three tables. So we have this batting data set, which has player ID, year ID, stint, and then we have this people data set, which has player ID and birth year and birth month, birthday, etc. And then we have the salaries, which is again year ID, team ID, league ID, and player ID and how much salary each player had. So the question now is to draw a diagram illustrating the connections between batting, people, and salaries. So I think when it comes to drawing a diagram that connects different data sets, it essentially boils down to identifying the primary keys in each of the individual tables, and then sort of linking it back to each of the, and connecting each of the tables. So from the batting data set, we had identified that player ID, year ID, and stint, the combination generates the primary key. Similarly, we use the same syntax to identify the primary key in the people data set. And there we see that player ID uniquely identifies all rows in the people data set. So we have zero rows right here. And finally, we have the salaries data set, and I sort of did a couple of permutations and combinations and saw that year ID, team ID, league ID, and player ID are kind of, that combination uniquely identifies all rows in our data set. So now that we know each of the primary keys, we can think of I did not draw the diagram out, but we can think of how this would work. So this player ID in the people data set would be connected to the player ID in the salaries data, and also the player ID in the batting data. And then a combination of this year ID and player ID from the salaries data would be linked to the player ID and year ID in the batting data. So yeah, so that is how we can think of approaching that diagram. So that takes care of the first two exercises. Next, we move to the second part of this chapter, where they talk about two different kinds of joins. And by join, I mean it's kind of a technique to integrate two different tables. So, for example, we have the flights data and we have the weather data or the airports data. How do we kind of connect these two data sets based on their primary key? So the authors here introduce a couple of very interesting concepts. The first one is the concept of a left join, which is nothing but if we have two data sets X and Y, left join is merging Y onto X, and they have some really cool diagrams to explain that. So the first one is, let's consider these two data sets X and Y, and X has row numbers 1, 2, and 3, values X1, X2, and X3, and Y has this primary key right here, which is 1, 2, and 4 instead of 3, and values Y1, Y2. Y2 and Y3. So they illustrate inner join through this diagram, where we have the primary key in both the tables right here. And a left join or an inner join is matching the primary key of the two tables and kind of retaining the values that match. So inner join would essentially mean that we'll only keep row 1 and 2, and we will not keep rows 3 or row 4, which do not have any match at all. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So yeah, so that's the simplest kind of join, where we are only joining when there is an absolute match in the keys that we have mentioned. If there's no match, the rows get dropped. So that was inner join. Then the authors talk about outer joins, and they say that there are three kinds of joins. There is left join, there is right join, and there's full join. And this diagram kind of clarifies it very nicely. So a left join, the way that it works is that whenever we do any kind of outer join, it creates this additional row, which has, so if we are kind of doing a left join, it would create an additional row in the right table, in the table to the right, and that row will have an NA value, and the primary key would be a blank. And by that blank, we mean that blank can, that the role of that blank primary key is that it can be matched with any unmatched primary key in the left table. So here we see that 1 and 2 found a match in the 1 and 2 primary keys 1 and 2 in the left table found matches in the right table. However, a primary key with ID 3 did not have a match, but that kind of got matched with this new dummy row that was created by this process. So that as in the final output, 3 is retained. And the value of 3 from the first table, X3, is retained, and its corresponding Y value is this NA value that is coming from this dummy row that was created. Did that make sense?
Yeah. I use joins all the time, and I really enjoy using it.
Okay. Yeah. Awesome. So yeah, I this concept was really nice to me because it helped me kind of visualize how R is working behind the scenes. So now that kind of that concept is kind of extrapolated to the right join, where the primary key in the right table gets retained, and the left column, the left table has this dummy row that gets created with NA values and a primary key that can match with anything. So when we do a right join, we have 1, 2, and 4 that get retained. 3 from the left table that did not have a match in the right table gets dropped. But 4 in the right table, which did not have an exact match in the left table, is retained because we had this dummy variable that was created in the left table. So yeah, and then using set theory, we can also imagine inner joins and then left full and right joins, where inner join is just the intersection between two sets. Left join is, where we are keeping everything in the left table and dropping anything that doesn't match in the right table. Right join is just the opposite. We are retaining everything in the right table and dropping everything on the left table. And full join is kind of a union of the two tables, where we are retaining everything and not dropping anything. So that was the concept. I really found that I never worked with joins before, so I found this really interesting. And then on the concept of duplicate keys, how does R treat duplicate keys? And this example again is, this graphic again is very helpful. So we have duplicate values here in the left table, and this is kind of a one-to-many relationship where, after the join, we have 1, 2, 2, and 1. So basically, all the rows in the left-hand side kind of gets, it gets retained. Since there are two duplicate rows here, the values from the right-hand side table gets duplicated. So we have x2 and x3 here, while from the y table we only have y2, which gets repeated twice. So that was the idea of duplicate keys. And then the authors say that, left join is the most common join. In fact, they go on to say that, if you find yourself to be using right join or some other kind of join, just recheck it. There might be some error in the data, or you might be doing something wrong. So left, 90% of our work would be managed by left join, is what it seems. And the syntax is pretty clear. We just mention left join, x and y, and then by, and mention the primary key that is common to both the tables. So with that, I'll just proceed with the exercises. So the first exercise was to compute the average delay by destination and then join on the airport's data frame so that we can show the spatial distribution of delays. And this is actually very similar to the first question in the first exercise that I sort of skipped. And let us take a look at that. So the idea is to first, compute the average delay by destinations, which I do by first grouping the destination and then summarizing the average delay and removing the missing values. And then the idea is that then the question asks us to join it with the airport's data so that we can show a spatial distribution. Now the airport's data had, the airport's table had information on airports. And let's take a look at that. So airports had this column called FAA, which is nothing but the name of the airport. And it corresponds to the, destination or the origin variables in the flight data set. And it also has Latin long values, which we can use to kind of create a map. So first, what we do is after we have grouped and summarized the average delay, we use the inner join function and select the airports table. And then within the airports table, we select the FAA column. We rename that as destination and also select the corresponding latitude and longitude values. And then we say that, okay, we want to do this inner join by destination. So let's see how this turns out. So here we have the flights data set and we have the destination, we have the average delay that we calculated. And now we also have the latitude and the longitude for each of these destinations. So that's the working of the inner join function. And then the rest of the part is plotting it on the US map, and the syntax is given here in the question itself. So when we run this, we kind of map the latitude and longitude and kind of pass on the value of average delay into the color to plot the spatial distribution of delays. So that was the first question. The next was add the location of the origin and destination. And by location, they mean latitude and longitude to flights. So this is very similar to the first question. The only difference is in the first question, we just added the latitude and longitude for the destination. Here it's asking us to do that for origin as well as the destination. So we kind of repeat what we did in the first question twice. So first we select the flights data set. We select, a few columns that we would be needing instead of the whole data. And then what we do is we just select from airports, we first rename the FAA column that we saw, which contained the name of the airport. We first name it as origin, and then we create a new variable for origin underscore lat and origin underscore long, which take the value of lat and long from the original, from the airport's data. And let's first look how this looks like. So we have flight, tail number, origin, destination, and then we have origin underscore latitude and origin underscore longitude. So this worked for us. All we now need to do is to repeat this process, just change the names of origin to destination. So instead of calling the FAA column as origin, we are now calling the FAA column as destination. We are calling the latitude function, but we are just renaming it as destination underscore latitude, destination underscore longitude. And the primary key that we pass on is destination, so that the FAA kind of matches with the destination column in the flights data. And the final product is that we have flight, we have tail number, we have origin, destination, we have origin lat long, and we have destination lat long, as the question had asked. We move on to the next question, which asks, is there a relationship between the age of a plane and its delays? This is very interesting. So what we first do is, again, we summarize by tail number, to uniquely identify the average delay for each plane. So this table gives us the tail number and the average delay for each plane. Now we go to the planes data set, which contains the tail number. And it also contains the year of manufacture or whatever, the year of commissioning or something like that. So we have the year variable right here. So based on this, we can calculate the age of the plane, because the New York flights dataset belongs, it was for all flights that departed from New York in the year 2013. So what we now do is we have already calculated the average delay for each of the planes. Now we use inner join, now we use left join to get the year of the plane into our data set. So we use the similar syntax that we have been using so far. We select from planes, we select tail number as tail number, and we also select here, and we get that into our data set. And now we have tail number and average delay and year. And based on this, now we create, we mutate a new variable, a new column called age underscore plane, which is nothing but 2013 minus the age of the plane. And we pass it on to ggplot to kind of develop a scatter plot with a geom smooth. And we see that there is, I mean, we don't really have a relationship between between the age of the plane and the average delay that that plane makes. So that's how we can, that's one way to approach, you know, the problem of understanding the relationship between age of a plane and its delays. The next question was also very similar. What weather conditions make it more likely to see a delay? So here, this calls for us to map things from the weather dataset, which has you know, information on origin, year, month, day, hour, and then a bunch of weather-related variables like temperature, dew, humidity, wind direction, wind speed, wind gust, precipitation, pressure, and whatnot. So what we can do now is, now the question says that, are weather conditions related to delay? So we start with the flights dataset. And first of all, we bring in, we do an inner join with the weather data. We match it on the basis of the primary key that we saw towards the beginning of the chapter. We saw that, you know, origin plus year plus month plus day plus hour, these were the primary keys in the flights data set. So we pass all of these keys to the inner join function as a vector, sort of a vector. And then say that, okay, you know, do an inner join with weather. So we have our new data set, which has, you know, all of that information on weather and wind gust and wind speed, etc. And then we group this data set by the primary key in the flights data, which was again, year, month, day, hour. And I for now, I just look at a couple of variables. So I group by this primary key, and I create a new variable called wind, which was the mean of the wind speed for that particular airport on a given day, on a given hour. Same for visibility. And we can go on for, you know, multiple other weather-related indicators, like we could do precipitation, humidity, so on and so forth. And then we have delay, which is the departure delay from the origin airport. And once we have calculated all of these means, I just take this one example where I plot visibility against the average delay. And we can do a similar thing for wind speed or humidity or what other variables as well. But just to make a point, we see that you know, as visibility, there's this sort of a, I don't know, decreasing relationship. So if visibility is really low, delay tends to be slightly high, but not really. It's more or less horizontal. So yeah, but that's the approach that we can take. We can now change this visibility to wind and run the same analysis. And had we calculated, you know, other mean values of other weather-related conditions, we could have done that. So wind speed and delay seem to have a increasing relationship. So if the wind's a positive association, so if wind speed is high, delays tend to be higher. That's what this says. But this data is again very sparse, so I'm not sure if we'll draw that conclusion. Finally, the last question in the exercise is what happened on June 13th, 2013? Display the spatial pattern of delays and then use Google to cross-reference with the weather. To get to June 13th to 2013, we filter it based on the year, month, and day. And then we group by destination to and kind of capture the average delay in destination to see what was happening. So this is what our flights table, this is what our flights table shows so far. So this is the delay by destination, the average delay by destination on that particular day. And then what we do is we do an inner joint with the airport's data and say that the key in our flights is destination and the matching corresponding key in the airport's data is FAA. So we create this we bring in the longitude and the latitude of the destination airports, and we already have the delays in the destination airports, and we then plot it using the same graph that we had seen earlier, where we see, you know, a spatial distribution of the delays that happened on June 13th, 2013. So we see that delays are, you know, there are the eastern part of the country, I think, saw more delays. And I did not look at the Google results, but it seems that, I mean, some weather conditions that might have affected the eastern part more than the western part of the country. So that is the end of the third exercise. I'll stop here for today, and we have three more exercises that we have remaining for this chapter, and we can pick it up on our next class. Does that work?
Sure. Thank you so much.